Jason, after a tumultuous 2020 for most commodity markets, what is driving that demand for base metals? We typically associate it with the manufacturing sector and construction. Is this a sign that the global economy is gearing up?
Yeah, it absolutely is. Now, part of the idea here in forecasting demand growth and economic growth, it has, you know, so much of that equation is disrupted right now. And rather than looking at traditional metrics regarding economic growth, we're really watching things like the success of the vaccine rollout, right? We're monitoring lockdowns, or the growth in the economy is going to be the result of government driving policy around economic activity, which just really, you know, it's nothing we've actually ever seen before. Now, that being said, what's really interesting, and I think on the other hand, when you look at medium to longer term, the fact that government policy is also driving structural trends in demand for metals actually creates maybe a lot more visibility than we would normally have when we're doing traditional economic forecasting. So the idea here being that infrastructure spending, whether it's in China or in the US, an uptick in infrastructure spending, which is explicit government policy, right, that we can really get our heads around, can drive demand growth for years and if not decades. The other major policy initiative, especially that we're seeing in the US, really catching up to the rest of the world, is towards decarbonization and the drive towards clean energy. So if you're building electric vehicles, if you're building wind and solar farms to replace coal-fired electricity generation, the demand for industrial metals in all of those sectors is currently and expected to continue to grow dramatically. And so if you have confidence that this government policy is going to be persistent and durable over time, then you have a lot of visibility into demand growth. And then, of course, when it comes to commodity prices, then you have to try to figure out, okay, well, how is supply going to respond over the long term as well? Because, you know, unlike other asset classes, supply can drive even more price volatility than demand over time. And so oftentimes we think, well, if demand is going up, well, that's what's needed to drive up commodity prices. But the oil markets are a perfect example where OPEC discipline with respect to supply is really what's driven crude oil prices higher over the last year and allowed them to recover. So as we look out, there isn't a cartel per se that controls metals prices the way that we see in energy markets, but calculating the supply response is just as important as forecasting demand when we look at our forecast for metals prices.
I want to pick up on something that you mentioned. Is China the primary driver behind this story?
China is a very important player. And we watch demand numbers in China very closely. But there's often, people are often looking for historical analogs to try to figure out what's going to happen this time around. That commodity super cycle, if you will, and we're not calling it a super cycle this time around, but that we saw in the late 90s through 2008 was very much driven by China and a few other emerging market economies industrializing themselves and really joining the modern economy. That's not really going to be the dominant dynamic this time around the way that it maybe was in the last cycle. However, China does, of course, play an important role. I mean, China installs, for example, in renewable energy. When it comes to electric vehicles, it's going to be the largest of those markets globally.
Let's talk about who's in the spotlight and who's kind of taking a back seat, if you will. We have cobalt and nickel, you know, stepping out to the forefront, and someone like zinc and I guess iron have kind of pulled back.
Yeah, what's really interesting is, you know, people tend to talk about commodities or even metals and they kind of put them into one category. You can get very high degrees of dispersion even across those individual metals, let alone amongst the different commodity sectors. So we definitely don't paint every commodity with the same brush. That being said, typically what will happen is as prices rise in one commodity, resources will pivot sometimes away from other related commodities to focus on where the most profits are, right? And then supply comes up and then that, you know, you'll see a price response in what's hot now, and then you'll see prices come back. So we think it's important not to get too caught up in the short term. You'll see copper run for a while, then aluminum will take its turn, then nickel will take its turn. It's important, I think, to own a diversified basket of metals if you're going to be a commodities investor, for example, because in the short term, you can get some noise in the numbers, but from a long-term perspective, they're all going to benefit. I do think it's interesting to watch those relative performances, but don't get too lost in the trees when it comes to individual performances.
Let's go back and talk about the supply side and those tight inventory levels. Mm-hmm. Will they ultimately lead to, and I heard you say that word, a super cycle?
So my preference right now, as far as descriptors is concerned, is probably something along the lines of a strong cycle, right? The last commodity super cycle that people remember, again, that ended around 14 years ago, was really driven in large part by crude oil going from $30 a barrel to 140. So we're not going to see that type of a move in energy markets. It's a completely different game these days. U.S. shale literally didn't exist at the time. So I don't think you're going to see the magnitude unless you get some sort of, cataclysmic event in the short term that could disrupt the supply. There's no reason to expect the magnitude of returns that we saw in the last cycle. However, we do see this sort of really positive fundamental backdrop that should support commodity prices over the next 10 years. And it's really something that it is a fundamental backdrop that we did not have in that 2010 through 2020 period, which was sort of a lost decade for commodities. This decarbonization theme is really a new dynamic in the market that has the potential now to drive demand for metals for decades to come. And it's a new phase. It's a bull phase in that sense, but it is a different distinct dynamic from the one that we saw when the BRICS were industrializing.
From an investment standpoint, which metal sectors do you have your eye on?
Well, from an investment standpoint, what's interesting is that what is investable is an important question. So lithium and cobalt and some of as you mentioned earlier, some of these, there are some industrial materials that really aren't liquid in the futures markets. For example, most of our investors access eventually these commodities through the futures exposure. They could buy an ETF or a mutual fund, but at the end of the day, we're owning futures when it comes to industrial metals. So copper, aluminum, zinc, iron ore, these are things that are investable. Cobalt and lithium, as I mentioned, nickel has become investable, but it wasn't really the very liquid, and we wouldn't have considered it investable for the retail consumer 15 years ago, but it is now. As we see liquidity continue to increase in futures that address these other markets like cobalt and lithium, then we could see investment opportunities arise that way. For now, investors are sort of relegated to trying to find equities that mine some of these less liquid minerals, right? But I think you're going to see this to be a very dynamic space over the next couple of years as interest increases and as liquidity in the derivatives that can access those markets from an investment perspective increase.